isolated, unarmed, elderly. It was the double murder of a loving couple brutally shot dead. For 26 years, the couple's family has fought to keep the killers in prison. But late last month, the ringleader was released. The family's afraid. They want to know where he is and what he looks like. They're asking corrections for a recent photo. Tamati Remini Sproat with the Jamieson story.
They decided, well, let's see what it's like to kill a human. Followed Dad down the hall and shot him in the back.
Margaret and Jock Jamieson.
Mum had called out. She was sitting up in bed, you know, what's going on? And he shot her in the stomach.
They've battled for 2 decades to keep the killers of Margaret's parents behind bars.
They've done this horrendous crime. They've not shown remorse.
It's not about vengeance. It's about protecting other people. We don't want anyone else to have to go through what we went through.
Let's pick some.
A quiet Kiwi couple.
There's a nice big one around here, Jock, that you probably can reach.
The Jamiesons should be enjoying a peaceful retirement together. Instead, they're still haunted by the horror that befell their family 26 years ago.
Dad was a softy. He didn't growl at us unless Mum told him to. Mum was tough. She kept us on the straight and narrow.
So you were a bit of a troublemaker growing up.
Yeah.
John Harrison was a World War II veteran who had distinguished himself for bravery. Mum Josephine was a florist. They'd been married since the war.
They still seem very much in love. Was that the case?
Yes. They were real good soulmates. And... Sorry. Okay. One couldn't do without the other.
The Harrisons owned an orchard in Henderson, West Auckland. But when the kids grew up and left, John and Josephine moved here to this farm in Te Ako, an isolated rural community west of Ngārua Wāhia. And why Te Ako?
Greenery, hills, not hearing children screaming around the neighbourhood and cars up and down the road. They were happy there. They got involved with helping at the Te Ako school. They would be judges for children's pet day. Quite often, Dad was Santa. He was a tall, slim fella. So I think he had to put on a bit of padding underneath.
They sold the produce they grew at their own roadside stall. Life was idyllic for 20 years.
Were you ever worried about how isolated your parents were?
Only when Mum and Dad started ageing. Mum's health was getting a bit worse. She had diabetes and it was affecting her eyes. Dad needed to have a hip operation and he wouldn't have it because they were stuck on the farm. I've just had my hip operation, so I know what pain he was going through just to keep on going with the farm. We cleared the room out and just put chairs all the way around.
And that's just in here, right? That's
our lounge, yeah.
On May 28th, 1994, John and Josephine Harrison celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary. Margaret pulled out all the stops to bring them up to her place in Auckland for the big day.
At one stage, we caught Dad out on the deck. He said, oh, I just need to sit down and it's too noisy in there. I sort of thought, you're supposed to be part of this process. Mum's in there yapping her head off, catching up with all her girlfriends.
Was it a very special day?
No, I'm not sure if I can say it. When we were... Our family weren't huggers, but when Dad was leaving that day, he gave me such a big hug. I was shocked. That was the last time we'd see them. Just was unbelievable, really.
An elderly Waikato farmer and his wife have been found shot dead at their home late yesterday.
We didn't believe that it was Mum and Dad. no, it's not them, no, they've got the wrong place. But as soon as that word murder formed in my brain, that was it.
I still vividly remember walking into the bedroom at the house. And, you know, those things you don't forget.
Local police detective Rex Miller couldn't believe what he was confronted with.
It was an execution, as far as I'm concerned, and it was something that we hadn't sort of seen before.
Ray followed Dad down the hall. Dad was going to the phone in the kitchen and shot him in the back. Dad was on the floor moaning, couldn't get to the phone. They shot him in the face.
Well, when I walked into the bedroom, there was an elderly lady. She was sitting up in bed and with gunshot wounds. And it was just horrendous.
Mum said something like, "Why are you doing this to me?" And so he shot her in the stomach. They were just housebound in the middle of the night. You know, it was execution.
Margaret's parents had been killed. What was going on? Who's doing that? So your mind just goes crazy. And I actually felt quite a bit of a fear, really. You know, like, could we be next?
Who were the killers? Where were they?
God knows what the hell was going to be in their minds and what they were going to do. So the sooner we got them off the streets, the safer everyone was going to be.
Just 3 days later, New Zealand got to see up close.
Yeah, you want a good look?
The face of evil, Gresham Marsh and Leith Ray.
They just had a real bad attitude. Thought they could do what they liked.
Marsh, 22, was the ringleader. Ray, 19, the yes man. Two drifters on a crime spree who targeted the elderly vulnerable Harrisons for a reason.
They decided, well, let's see what it's like to kill a human, and had the cheek to say Mum and Dad had lived long enough.
Yeah, I remember that comment.
So he actually said that?
Yeah.
Were you shocked by those comments?
Well, they're pretty shocking, really, aren't they?
Do you think they showed any remorse at the time?
None.
Margaret and family were at court to see Marsh and Ray plead guilty. The judgment was swift. Life.
We sort of said, well, thank goodness they've been sentenced to life. You know, we just thought life meant life. We didn't know it meant 10 years.
They killed two people. Had they killed one or 10, the sentence would be precisely the same. And that didn't seem to make sense to us.
Margaret and Jock could have just accepted it, but they're not those kind of people. Incredibly, as it turns out, Gresham Marsh's family weren't either.
I just know from my gut, from my heart, that Gresham cannot be rehabilitated. I know the way my brother thinks.
The Marshes adopted Gresham as a child, but Sharon said as he grew up, the family became alarmed at his increasingly violent behaviour.
The family started to really think, my God, he is going to kill somebody very soon.
Sharon and Margaret became close.
She was more of a sister, I would say, because my sisters departed. Wouldn't have anything to do with me because I was speaking to the media. And I just took Sharon on as my sister, in a sense. And she's so strong.
This devastated our family, not to mention what it did to the Harrisons.
When Marsh and Ray came up for parole in 2005, Margaret, Jock and Sharon fought to keep them in prison. They haven't stopped fighting since.
For a period of 16 years, we have been in the face of the parole board, eyeball to eyeball. We've been battling all these years, fearing that one day they would let him out and hoping it would have an influence so that they would actually keep him in. Finally, they stopped listening. They made a decision, and we are stuck with that decision now.
Leith Ray was released in 2015, and a fortnight ago, Gresham Marsh was released from prison after 26 years inside.
There'll be people watching this who would say, surely he's paid the price for what he's done. What have you got to say to those people?
It's not about vengeance. It's about protecting other people. We don't want anyone else to have to go through what we went through. The parole board have put into writing that he is at very high risk of reoffending. Why would you let him out?
When Leith Ray was released, Corrections provided a recent photograph of him to the Jamiesons.
We'd asked the same question for Marsh, and we'd been denied a photograph.
This was the last image of Gresham Marsh that Margaret and Jock saw decades ago.
Do you know what Gresham Marsh looks like now?
No.
Do you know where he is?
No.
Do you know what he's doing now that he's out?
No. Have we bumped into him? How would we know? Should we know? I think we should.
We asked Corrections for an interview, which they declined. In a written statement, National Commissioner Rachel Leota says Corrections has offered to show the Jamiesons a recent photo of Gresham Marsh, but won't let them keep one. Corrections says it's required to protect personal information, including that of offenders. Marsh is residing in the South Island, has 29 parole conditions, and is being electronically monitored.
They believe they're doing us a favour by offering for us to have a supervised view of a photograph. If you see an image of a photograph today, can you recognise that guy in a couple of years' time? Of course not. A photograph is what we actually need.
As far as Margaret and Jock Jamieson are concerned, it's simple.
Margaret and I had for 26 years tried to keep him inside. If he was to feel aggrieved, could we potentially be at risk? Yes, we could. And we have no protection whatsoever. Our right to recognise the offender should supersede any right to his privacy.
Well, Corrections spokesperson Rachel Leota acknowledges this is a particularly distressing time for the Jamiesons. She says public safety is their top priority, and if Gresham Marsh breaks his parole conditions, it will be taken extremely seriously.